So we've already alluded to some of the issues with moderate stage Alzheimer's disease, specifically behaviors. And I think if I polled each of you, you probably would be able to list 4, 5, or 6 different variations on a theme. But as I said, we can see anger, irritability, suspiciousness, paranoia, wandering, obsessiveness, hoarding, spitting, kicking, swearing. We can see disinhibition. They can be more sexually disinhibited, try to disrobe, come on to other family members, be overly friendly with strangers, more impulsive. So you have them in a store and they see a candy bar and they are going to pick it up. More childlike in their understanding of and their ability to function in the world. Not only is memory becoming more affected in the moderate stage, but the languages as well. And let's remember that language has 4 components to it. 1 is the ability to understand. 2 is the ability to express oneself. 3 is the ability to read. And lastly is the ability to write. And all of these become progressively impaired in moderate stage so that at some point they're no longer able to read or write, and their ability to express and understand becomes much, much simpler. And this can take a number of forms. 1, you'll notice that you have to give very simple directions. No longer can you give them 3 or 4 things to do. A key thing to remember with language is that the person with Alzheimer's disease becomes very attuned to what your face is saying and what your body language is saying. Even when they can't understand the words, they can understand what they're seeing in body language. So you need to be very careful if you're feeling stressed or angry or anxious, because they will feed off of it. They will essentially mimic what you are feeling. So we want them to be as stress-free, as anxiety-free as they can be. That means that sometimes you have to hide your own stress. You have to put on literally the happy face. And I realize that can be a significant challenge as a care provider when you yourself may be feeling the same symptoms of anxiety and depression, worrying about how are we going to make it through, feeling tired from assuming all of these responsibilities. In the early stage, as you've been working with social workers or people from the Alzheimer's Association or other community agencies, you would have been developing a plan, financial and legal planning, for what the needs might be as time marches on with Alzheimer's disease. And this is the time that that plan goes into effect. I already commented on the powers of attorney are now in effect, as they can't make financial and medical decisions. This is where you now begin to tap into what are those extra resources that can help me help my person, that can give me a break, that can give them a sense of some independence and things to look forward to and keep them safe. So this is where we say we're using Plan B. We're looking at those resources and we're looking at what do we need to make those resources happen. We've talked about vulnerability, that ability to understand a situation, to recognize an emergency and be able to respond to it. But vulnerability is also just that sense of psychological comfort. And I think this is the other little pearl that we want to hang on to in terms of where does anxiety come from. So if I can't make sense of the world and you're leaving me alone, and even in early stage we see this, if people are being left alone, it creates distress, it creates angst. And what we want is psychological comfort. And at a point when they're feeling that angst or distress with being left alone, that's that moment of vulnerability, that's that moment that we want to step in provide the 24/7 supervision, the constancy of care and support, the predictability of routine so that they have that sense of psychological comfort. That means that we're also ensuring their overall safety because we're always there to make sure that they're not turning the stove on and leaving it on, that they're not using inappropriate products in the microwave, that they're not getting out of the house because we've put extra locks on the doors. All of those enter into how do we keep them safe. And then even more is whether we are going to need to or want to place our loved one. That's a highly personal decision. There's no right or wrong to that. There are those who feel strongly they want to keep their loved one at home. It's totally possible, but only when there is extra help in the home. Things can change in a moment, even for the health and welfare of the care provider. We often worry, in fact, about the care provider dying first, kind of the cumulative effects of stress. And in general, we're looking at somebody who is aging themselves and has health issues. So we need to pay attention to the welfare and emotional and physical well-being of you, the caregiver, and whether it's feasible to continue to keep somebody at home. We talked earlier about delirium. We call that the voice of dementia. So as time goes on and language is more impaired, and there's a disconnect in terms of what a person is feeling and expressing to you, they may not be able to tell us that they feel like they're coming down with something or that they're hurting in a specific area. Fairly early on, we may notice that they complain of things like back pain for almost a week straight, so you make an appointment with the doctor, but by the time you get to the doctor, they say, "What pain? I don't have any pain." So it's important that you play the detective, and when you are seeing these kinds of complaints or seeing the grimace that goes along with it or the reluctance to move an arm or a leg, that's when you need to translate to the doctor or advocate for your loved one that this is what they've been saying, this is the situation under which I've noticed it, and it's been going on for about this long, okay? When we talked about Alzheimer's disease in general, we talked about this sort of insidious onset and gradual slow decline. When we see a very sudden change in hours or days, that can be more confusion, agitation, or swing the other way. They can be so out of it that you almost are questioning whether they're alive. They're not responsive. That's the delirium. That's the body acting out the fact that there's something going on medically or physically. The typical scenario is a urinary tract infection, but we can look at things like pneumonia, viral illnesses, or a whole host of other medical or physical issues, changing kidney function, liver function, that can create that change in level of alertness and confusion. So when we see that very sudden change, like I said, over hours to days, that's a marked difference from their sort of general confusion, that's when you want to call your primary care physician and say, "I think there's something going on. We need to come in and get checked out." And in the absence of any findings, then sometimes we're just seeing a gradual progression in the Alzheimer's disease and its symptoms, and we may need to treat with medications.